The organization, as I said, is in our third year. We have so many challenges because, one, community resistant. The resistance is big. As I said, they do not understand why we are saying no to this. For them, it's culture, but as you're saying, it's the law, you know. So, and we try to educate them, but sometimes we are forced to arrest them. I mean, use the law to arrest them because sometimes the kids' rights are violated. And when you find a 9, 10-year-old is married or she has to undergo FGM before, because here FGM and child marriage goes hand in hand. If you are to get married today and you are 11 years old, you have to undergo the FGM so that you get married. So when you tackle these things, we tackle them together. You cannot separate them, but you have to make them understand why. So there's a lot of resistance from the community. For them, they don't realize it's a law. They say it's their culture, and they've been doing it. So I should be told to stop now. So it's a battle with the community. Secondly, we also lack the political goodwill, basically, in the county, because the men are silent about it. But the women actually have come forward and been bashing our work and not wanting us to educate the people, and they don't care about, you know, they try to trash what we're doing. But for us, we said it's not about them anyway, it's about the people, it's about the community, for them to get to know the truth about the constitution, the laws of this country. And because when they will be arrested, those politicians will be nowhere to be seen, and that it's the people to answer for themselves. So for us, we are creating awareness so that the community can be enlightened on these things. The other big challenge you have is funding. Because every time we rescue a child, she becomes fully under the foundation, the Samburu Girls Foundation. So it's right from uniform to schools to the boarding, I mean paying, if it's primary school, paying their boarding schools and buying them all that shopping. Or if it's high school, paying also their school fees is all on us. And we've tried to reach out even to the county government, but yeah, we've not got any support so far. And our aim now is to even build a rescue center, because sometimes when you rescue these kids, there's tension. The family do not want the girl back immediately, so we have to keep her away, counsel her, take her through, so that by the time even she goes to school, when she closes school, she can either go back to school, and I mean to the parents, we reconcile them at some point, so she can go home for the holidays, but we still monitor her, because they are never safe until the family has really accepted them back. So our work is difficult, because if you look at the terrain in Samburu, covering from east to north, it's so diverse, vast, very vast, and sometimes when you have a case to report and there's no network coverage in most of the areas, and you want some, even when you inform the community and they want to reach out to us for help, sometimes they can't because they don't have even a network to call us. So I think there's so much that yet need to be addressed in this county, and especially. Like donors who sit in Nairobi and say they are fighting these things and they don't know the real issues because they are not coming to the village level. And sometimes they fund either organizations and they don't monitor their money where it goes. Because if you find today we did a successful 30 women training on issues affecting them, and it was coming from them, and it was up to them to choose whether they'll continue doing it and they'll be against the law, or they are going to stop it so that they are safe from the law. So what I would recommend is if organizations are doing FGM, let them stop the hotel trainings. You know, if a hotel training today will spend so much, but you can do 10 community meetings with the same money, so, and you'll have reached more people than coming to train 30 people in a hotel and you will use a lot of money, and while those 30 people would have spent the same amount to reach out to the more of the community. So for me, I think it's there's so much money being pumped out there, either for FGM, child marriage or other issues or harmful cultural practices, but it's not reaching the people who really need it. Because at the end of the day, we are telling them to stop, but it will take time for them to immediately stop. So those individuals, 1, 2, 3, or 10, will start stopping. They'll have repercussions from the community. And what happened next is, if this girl is empowered, she would want to run away. And if she runs away, who will support her? So we need more organizations to do this, yes, but to truly do it from their hearts to help these people, because sometimes we hear organizations by names, but we don't see what they are doing. And we also ask the leaders to support the organizations doing this so that they are also able to reach out, because it's actually their mandate. As leaders, as a government, it's them who are supposed to be bringing this information, because laws are passed by them, the elected leaders. And when they reach the ground, they keep quiet about it because of the votes. So I think it's time also the Kenyan leadership shifts from just politics into service delivery. Thank you. So I think this thing began in me a long time ago when I was still in school, primary school, because I'm the first born in my family. My mom was married, was taken out of school in form two to be married to my dad as a third wife, and she swore that her kids will go to school. So she fought for us to be in school. My dad passed on when we were young. So we also have a wife inheritance in Samburu community. So she refused to be inherited so that she can still have control of our household. So she made sure we went to school. With the support of the church, I was able to go to school and finish and became a nurse. I'm a nurse by profession. And while I was still in school, I kept rescuing my own cousins who were being married off or who are at home, be dead and not going to school. Actually, the first cousin I've rescued when I was still in primary school is now a medical doctor. She just graduated there from Moi University. And so I continued while in school and made sure that, when I finished my nursing school, I wanted to work back in Samburu. So I came back, kept rescuing these girls and looking for individuals to sponsor them or organizations. And most of them I used to pay their school fees with my own salary. So when the girls became many, I had to leave my job and start the organization so that I was able to reach out to more girls and go, because it has become my passion. Though in primary school, when I was in class four, my classmate was getting married, so I left Samburu and went to study in Meru, in a boarding school. And from there is when I saw the difference. Why is this? Here, girls are finishing school, but back in Samburu, every term we are depleted. Like by lower primary, there are so many. By mid primary, there are no girls. By the time exams are being done, either one or no girl is doing exams. So I saw there's a difference. So I think my childhood experience and seeing other girls being married earlier made me just think that I should intervene in somehow to bring some change in my community.